I would like to speak about some modest contribution of LibreOffice community to the outside world about import filters for some vector graphic formats and about the fun that this reverse and straight engineering means for us. Very shortly, who I am. I'm Friedrich, I'm a software engineer in SUSE LibreOffice team. I have diverse background, and even before being employed by SUSE, I was doing file format converters, like WordPerfect converter, WordPerfect graphics filters. And I work on LibreOffice in my company time, and I work on LibreOffice in my free time. And sometimes my wife, she reminds me that. So, what is the agenda of the presentation? So, to present the import filters, and also to explain a little bit how we do it. Valik, he showed the tools, and I would like to show how we actually try to optimize the development process so that we actually can produce something in a relatively short time. And this part is just because this thing will be published on the web, and normally what happens, I always receive a lot of email from Ayatollahs of only free software, free standards, and telling me that I actually do that thing for free and open source software by supporting proprietary formats. So I want to explain why we do it. It is true that ODF, Open Document Format, is the future of humanity. The problem is that the humanity doesn't know about it as of now. So we have some time between humanity realizes something and it's the truth. So, and there are other de facto standards. Some people use other office suites and graphic applications, and it's good to support them also. And the other reason is that we have users and they have hard disk full of bad finished poetry and indecent drawings in funny formats, and LibreOffice offers the freedom to read the pile of and also it's interesting for me because it's an intellectual exercise to take something that is a binary blob and do something structured from it. So, and also it allows me to be a LibreOffice developer without actually understanding LibreOffice, because I work just on some libraries and I have some 100 line of code of glue, and I can pretend that I'm a LibreOffice developer. And also we do it for users because they will be happy, they will be, you will be there. If you do something like this, you will be the hero of the users because they can read the documents, but then they suddenly also discover that there are features they would like to have, and they start to get on your nerves. So it's all a fun. So import filters that are available to all, resulting from the work of LibreOffice community. Existing ones, I speak about graphic file formats. We have also text document file formats, but given the auditorium, I didn't want to really spam you with too much information. So there is WordPerfect Graphics, that was the first graphic file format that we did in using my framework. And it was started by a certain guy in Holland who is working for games industry and me. And it was completed almost in a Google Summer of Code in 2006 by a certain Arya Hidayat. Maybe some of you know who it is. So it's quite a good KV developer. The Visio Import Filter and LibVisio, it was our last year's Google Summer of Code. It was done by Valek, me, and Ili McAdam, a talented PhD student from University of Dundee in Scotland. And now we for the 3.6 we continued the reverse engineering of the CorelDRAW file format, and as Valek said, we are supporting all file formats that CorelDRAW ever used, from version 1 from 80s until the last released on 20th of March. we are actually proud of it because it was quite fun to reverse the old ones because they looked completely different on the first look than the new ones. So if you want to see, it is on in our developer builds. You can install, they are even for Linux, not just for Windows and Mac. So you can install it and you can run it. It's on their builds, LibreOffice.org. If you find something that is younger than 2-3 days, it's it will have the newest stuff. Now, concerning future directions, I prefer to speak about future when it becomes feature, because the path to hell is paved by good intentions, and there are many, many projects out there that produced roadmap, and some 5 years after the roadmap is still on the web. So, and I think also that code and feature, when you can see things, is more attractive than PRs. So, but it's true that we have a Google Summer of Code 2012. We will make an attempt at MS Publisher file format. We know the structures. We know what to do with it. We have a student that is a mathematician from Arizona, so we hope that he will be able to work with us, because we are a little bit special. So, and then there is also Valak's personal pet file format that is Macromedia Freehand. And I don't really want to implement it, so, but Valak is trying to fundraise for it, and he can convince me with some coins that to develop something around it. So now, how we did it? We woke up and it was done. Oh. So we went from a principle that no wheel should be reinvented, and almost no wheel should be reinvented, and we learned from our big competitor that the best is to reuse, embrace, and extend. So we are using ODF as interchange format because this is the way filters communicate with LibreOffice. We are feeding SAX messages. We are feeding XML as SAX messages to LibreOffice in flat ODF file format. It's a specified thing. It's not very important anyway. And we are using, the first library was libwpg for the WordPerfect graphics file format. So we use the API of libwpg so that we don't have to redesign APIs and we don't have to complicate our life too much. And we have this ODF generator class that actually is, the API is an interface with callback functions, and this one takes that interface, and when the functions are called, it will output the SAX messages. So already we have a linear interface. Okay, I will show you how it looks. Maybe it will be even visible there. What this helps? It helps to be quick, because you don't have to write any boilerplate code. And it's, for example, for each file format, the LibreOffice part of it is about 100 lines of code, if I don't count white space lines and comments. And the core is as a standalone library, and it allows you to have regression testing on the library. So, because many times we are trying to understand, we implement something, and then when we change it, maybe we mess up something before. So it's good to be able to regression test the commits. So our graphic representation is basically callbacks that take start graphics, end graphics, and different graphic primitives and styles, and also some text objects. And we, from the library, we call these callbacks. There are some conventions, like every graphic had to start by start graphics, and every page finishes by end graphics, and new page by start graphics, because if I don't do this, I will crash, because I assume that. So, but basically, this interface is understandable. You can send it primitives, and it will serialize it. into what you need. VFK classes, they are the ODG generator class, that is implementation of this interface. We have one header that is determining the sex interface, and then each library, I know it's a bit suboptimal, but each library has an SVG generator class that basically, as you parse the document, it generates SVG. Because of certain people who were interested in using this for importer, it outputs an array of SVG documents per page. Because SVG doesn't support in current version pages, and since Microsoft Visual and CorelDRAW can have multi-page documents, the output pages at separate SVGs, we have an array class, you can know how many of them are, and you can call them by index. And they are not a bit header, and they put everything in SVG namespace, so that it's easier to embed them in XHTML, because already you don't assume that it's flattened, the SVG interface, in SVG namespace. But you can also add SVG header, and it can be read by Inkscape directly. I plan to rework a little bit the API to put this SVG generator as a part of public API, but since these libraries, they are C++ libraries, adding anything, it basically messes everything because the pointers, the classes will not be the same, and Debian maintainers, they will kill me. So why we do this thing? Because it's sure that ODF is not a trivial file format, it's not a linear file format. You first have styles, then you have automatic styles, you have fewer definitions, and after you have the content, and it makes more sense to have a linear interface and abstract this thing in another class and not to bother about it anymore. Also, it helps to reuse instead of copying the generators, and we don't waste time designing interface. And it speeds up the development by we focus on essentials, on reading the file format and producing something. Now, what was our file format documentation? Basically none. For libwpg, for the first one, there is some documentation, but even there, what is written, you have to check it. It's like my wife, when I tell her that I'm going to do something, she always checks that I actually did it. So that is, the documentation works in the same principle that you can't trust it unless you saw that actually it works. So for Visio, there was a marginally useful user and developer documentation on MSDN that defines the bit concept. There is a possibility to save in some XML representation so that you can see how they dump the concepts into an XML file. And for libcdr, I used what was in Oletoy and in Valek's previous CDR Explorer. And there is also a document that explains a bit CMX. CMX is Corel so-called exchange presentation file format that they bothered to document. And that one gives some hints about what certain enums mean, so that if you find in a file a hex code, you can try to map it to some meaningful thing from the documentation. And so basically all is reverse engineering, and it's based on Valek's work with Oletoy. Now, the development method, our principle always is results. We want to see something early, because it is also very encouraging for us not to have just a lot of code that does nothing, but have a little code that does something. So first we extract rasters, because rasters, there are many loaders that LibreOffice has, so basically we can all known raster file formats, we can render them directly. And next, in next graphic primitives, and for Visio and for CDR, we basically convert everything in paths because it starts to be a bit complicated with rounded rectangles that have all the corners different, and then they scale, and it's better. And also, as I scale the path, it's easier for me to have two, three things to scale instead of scaling whole shapes. I know how to scale elliptical arc, how to scale and transform Beziers, and how to do with lines, and I'm happy and I don't need to know anymore. And also the tools that we have, we don't produce specs because that takes time, and also he's not a developer, I'm not a spec writer, so we develop the tools as the implementation goes. The OLED toy gets improved every time. Like yesterday we did some new parsing of 16-bit CMX files, and it's always driven by a need of implementation, and it reflects the understanding of the file format, but also it avoids us to get into dead ends where we would try to solve a problem that we actually don't have. Information that is not useful for me, I don't need to know it. So, until it becomes useful for me. This is just a refreshment that I want to say that we are also a project that has a girl. So, this is the team. And more about the development. We design the software as we go, because some code is better than abstract design. If we find a bug, we fix them. We are not scared to produce bugs. And also, we use Git as our main communication model. We commit, if we find that it doesn't work, it's not an email against email against email, it's a commit that fixes it by someone else. And also, that allows us and the people who are working with us to learn from the mistakes instead of being stewing in their corner until they feel really ashamed to ask for help. And also, we have this funny free software principle we are releasing very often. Every 2-3 weeks, we have a release. Like the libcdr library is now on the version 0.0.7. Because it's good to have some intermediary targets and hit them and say, okay, now I hit this target, I release. What else I want to say? What is interesting, by late when we were doing something that I called incremental reverse engineering, we were extending the file format coverage, and we departed from a point that, as a software developer, I know that if there is a release of an application 1 year, and 6 months after there is an application that has another format, I don't see a company who will rewrite in 6 months completely the way they store data. So we are always looking for a common DNA in the file formats, even if maybe before it was RIF, now we are not having RIF, we are still trying to find similar structure. So normally we try to parse the lower and the higher versions using the existing parser. That's why we designed the parser the way that we never copied. We say, okay, now we are at version 16, so we put everything that is bigger than 16, we parse this way. When the version 17 comes, if we try to parse it and we see where it goes. Our debugging build is so verbose that it can load a file during 5 minutes. And it spits megabytes and megabytes of debugging information, but it helps me to see where actually I threw exception and go in the file in that place and check what changed between versions. And we fix the issues as they appear, and we try to parse again until we parse. And that is an important thing, that we have a small set of reference documents that we always save in the file formats. For example, we have one document where you have rectangles of different types with different type of fields. So if something in bitmap field changes, we know it because it will crash there. And it's also importance of having a working parser for other versions. It means that not to cut the parser at all. And also the other thing is that experience makes a difference, because sometimes the hex dump, you can look at it and you say, we were looking for transformation matrices now in version 3 and version 2 and 1 of CorelDRAW, and we couldn't find it because what we were looking for was another encoding of floating point numbers. But then I actually remember that I remember some Mac versions of WordPerfect were encoding things certain way with integer part and fractional part, and we tried to apply this knowledge and we actually found the matrix. Those are intuitions that help in Valer has a lot of this kind of intuition. Me, I had one, that's why I mentioned only one, and I say that it's an example. So now, if you have some questions or want to stone me, I am here. Just to know that, for example, I learned 2 weeks ago that our direct competitor, Caligra, is using our Visual library. So I hope that I will have co-developers. So, yes?
Yeah, just something about the freehand file format. Because in the last presentation, I didn't get that it was a pet project. And I was really excited to see that work was being done there, because most of us, for instance, where I come from in Portugal, there are still printing houses that ask for freehand files because they really can't make the transition yet. And being able to convert our legacy work to SVG and not to Illustrator would be really super. And you did mention the crowdsourcing effort for freehand. If you had some details on that,
we can discuss. We can discuss money for all of them, no problem. Mm-hmm. You know, just to explain the crowdsourcing, this thing is, it looks easy here, but it requires time. And the time has to be divided between hobby, regular job, and incompressible part. I was thinking it was compressible, but I realized lately that this incompressible part is wife. So, if you compress that too much, then it expands and it creates problems. And you can increase the compression ratio by actually earning some money of it, because that it falls in the work part and not leisure part. So we are trying because we can't go like this forever, working nights they wake up and there is nobody there. So that's why we are trying to fundraise, not huge money. Okay, if there is huge money, we will not do things. But we are trying to fundraise so that we can have it a bit paid. So. But we know the file format enough so that we know that we can actually deliver it.
Is it published somewhere?
No. Published file formats are not very interesting for us. It's not fun.
No,
because anybody can do that.
There is fh.pi and fhparse.pi as part of CorelDRAW. It's not an implementation, but if you open version 10 or 11 file, it will show you what's inside. It still requires a lot of mapping between reality and file content, because for multiple file formats, I've started with something which I have no idea what's inside. Like for CDW, which is a hack, I have no idea what's inside. I just was able to find from few files how the structure looks like, and implement an auditory ability to take a file and split it into parts. So after that, we need to take an application, create some test files with known values, and try to find those values in the parts of the file. That's how we are doing now with text support and CorelDRAW. We were able to split record which have styles, right? So I it took us a lot of attempts, and before I implemented the whole paper, I was unable to do that, right? Just because I need to do all this weighing, all the lines and all that stuff. But now we are able to split it, and after that we just need text files which have some specific features, and we look for those values inside of the split parts, and we can say, okay, oh, this one set of records is just for bullets, and this one for hyphenation, right. And this one just encodes linkage between styles and quality in the object with styles in a set of styles.
Right.
Same for freehand. We already passed over all structure. I was able to produce something, right? But to make it right, we need to generate some files and map.
Right.
Coordinates of where shape here would be encoded in that part of the record. Something like that. But if you want to understand how it works in general, it's already here. You need to speak Python.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really hard language, but I had to learn it before. So that's it, this side. So come and pick your computer, I don't want to touch it, it's in Russian.